time to be reaping, a time to be sowing the green leaves of summer. Are calling me home. It was good to be young then, in the season of plenty, when the catfish were jumping as high as the sky. A planting, a time just for plowing, a time to be courting a girl of your own. Was so good to be young then, the green leaves of summer are calling me home.
The green leaves of summer. Welcome to Joe's Records and Tapes. That just means my living room and all of my records. How are you guys doing out there? We just heard a really interesting record, a weird one. That was Tex Ritter. Tex Ritter, the singing cowboy of Hollywood. Backed by Stan Kenton, the jazz innovator of the 40s and 50s, who was an early employer of Art Pepper, and we're here to talk about Art Pepper today. So I thought I'd start with Green Leaves of Summer, Tex Ritter. Some fun facts about this record before we start. See this weird instrument here? It's called a mellophonium, I just learned. Invented in 1957 as a kind of, retrofitted French horn that would go forward instead of up, and was popularized by Stan Kenton. It's just a thing you can know. And then Tex Ritter, father of Jack Ritter from Three's Company. It's true. And a very strange record that you could probably get for a dollar, and it's worth it. So I'm very happy today because I'm going to have LAURIE Pepper, who is the flame keeper of the legacy and the memory and the story of Art Pepper, who is one of my favorite jazz saxophone players and one of my favorite musicians. You know, in the past times, I've said that past episodes, I always make a point of saying that I think the great artists are the ones who have a great story. You know, there are incredibly talented musicians out there whose story just has all the excitement of, the life of an insurance salesman. For whatever reason, things just worked out great for them. I'm sure they had a fine life, but their story isn't necessarily exciting. I've mentioned the Beach Boys in the past. You can't listen to the Beach Boys without thinking of how, tragic and amazing that story is, and it's built into the music. Well, that goes for Art Pepper. And, his story was told so eloquently in what I consider the greatest music memoir ever written, Straight Life, which I'm going to just repeatedly recommend to you tonight. So briefly, I just want to say, my little adventure with Art Pepper began when I found this record called Living Legend. I know it's all backwards for you, but I found it at a street vendor on the Upper West Side. Had a bunch of books and records. It didn't look promising. A lot of Andy Williams, Barbra Streisand, you know the Piles, and the Mitch Mitchell, not Mitch Mitchell, the other Mitch, singing along with Mitch. And I found this, so suddenly I just kept going, and there it was, this Art Pepper record, Living Legend. And what struck my, I had already been curious about him, but then I see this record and he's got these like prison tattoos on his arms. He's looking kind of rough. He looks like he's lived, looks like there's a story there. And so I bought it and I was off to the races, became obsessed, read the book Straight Life, which I will tell you was co-authored by Laurie Pepper, because she, as we'll learn, had so much to do with constructing it from his voice. And in his voice, and the beauty of his playing is really so autobiographical. Unlike maybe some other technically proficient, amazing players, his is really a pure expression of who he is. So I'm going to play a track from this that's the one that really nabbed me, that inspired me, that got me totally into him. And I have to say, I listened to this song, and I feel like I read his book before I read his book from listening to this song. I knew when I listened to this that I was listening to somebody who had had an incredible lot of tragedy, a lot of heartache. I mean, listen, the title is Lost Life, so, you know, it was right there in black and white, but it's an incredible song, and I think it will give you an immediate feeling for how pure of a player he was, and how beautiful a player he was. So let's listen to it real quick. That's not it. There we go. I'm going to get out of the picture. Right. So that song kind of speaks for itself. Lots I could say about that. It's incredibly moving. Track from Living Legend that was recorded in 1975. The other guys on this are all guys he played with in the 50s. Hampton Hawes, fellow junkie and convict who had, you know, had his own trials. Shelly Mann on drums, and Charlie Hayden, the great Charlie Hayden, on bass. I mean, an incredible lineup of guys. A lot of this is the making of these records, if you're interested in those kinds of things. I mean, and the kind of backstory and the emotional backstory. I mean, every record that this guy made, if you read his book or if you read Laurie's book, Art, Why I Stuck with the Junkie Jazzman, unbelievable kind of sequel, really, to Straight Life. Fantastic book also. And, you know, just a quick compressed version is that Art Pepper, Los Angeles, California, really at the heart of, you know, the West Coast jazz scene in the 50s. Really unlike the rest of the West Coast jazzers in a lot of ways, because he was not a cool player. He was a very hot, ballad, emotional player, like you just heard. And then the junk took over his life, and he spends a large deal of the 60s in prison. And the trials of his prison life are all documented in this book. Which, you know, just one of the many blurbs on the back here says, the most powerful, mind-riveting, brutally honest document I've ever read by an artist. I mean, and I agree. So if you're interested in something amazing to read, I just want to say really quickly, concurrently with me getting obsessed with Art Pepper, I happened to be profiling Beto O'Rourke for Vanity Fair magazine. And I noticed he had a record player in his living room, and he had a Stan Getz record on when I showed up, and I just noted that, wrote it in my notebook, and I told him that he had to have this, and I sent it to him. So for what it's worth, there's a copy of this in Beto O'Rourke's record pile. I don't know how much he appreciated the story I wrote. It was a positive story, but, you know, he kind of flamed out quicker than he probably would have liked. That's another story. I only have time for one more song before I'm going to bring Laurie on, and we're going to chat about Art. But, you know, he had a big comeback after all these trials in prison. He was in a kind of rehab commune called Synanon. That's a whole other crazy story. That's where he meets Laurie. She's got her own kind of crazy life that leads up to this moment where they meet and they become partners. And she kind of becomes his muse and his manager and his... you know, kind of, I don't know. I don't want to say like, you know, she helps prop him up in a lot of ways. And it's a trial for her, but it's also, she knows that he's a genius, and there's this complicated, emotional connection that they have that, you know, both ends up the final result of, which is all these incredible albums he made before he died, at age 56 in the early 80s. I mean, because his body really just didn't hold up from all the abuse. But he kind of broke through in 1977 at the Village Vanguard. He did a run, all of which came out as records, which I highly recommend. But amazing, just to give you a sense of like how these records, you hear them on the record, you're like, hey, that guy's a pretty good player. You don't really realize like how like kind of half devastated he was physically in his body when he was doing this, and it's almost like the pain of having of what he went through to get that expression out to the end of that horn is immense. It's all this life stuff that he went through. But so this record I'm going to play for you is the one that Laurie said was her favorite that he ever recorded, or it says, I'll quote her, If there's any track on any album that sums up the beauty and power of Art's triumphant soul, his gift, it's Goodbye. He played that night at the Village Vanguard and dedicated to his old friends, Hampton Hawes, who had played on that record, who had recently died. For me, it's the strongest, most passionate performance he ever gave. So I'm going to lay it on you because, you know, if she says so, I believe her. And it's on a beautiful, there's a, you know, for you record geeks, there's a beautiful box set of the all three nights that you can get on a record, which I always recommend records because they sound really beautiful, especially these records made by contemporary. So we're going to listen to Goodbye, and then we're going to talk to LAURIE. It's kind of a long track, and I hope that you'll indulge it. You know, I mean, just turn on your Bluetooth speaker and put your phone down and relax. It's going to be great. You're going to enjoy this. Just, you know, you're not going anywhere. Nobody's going anywhere. That's why it's so kind of, that's why we're doing this, right? That's why we're here. Let's enjoy it. Thank you. To fade out and bring in LAURIE Pepper. LAURIE, if you're there, get ready. And I apologize for fading out. I don't like to do that. But I want to.
Hi.
Thank you.
That in so long. Oh my God, that's so beautiful.
Isn't it? Yeah.
It's like right up there. It's incredible.
Well, wow. I was just following him on that solo, and there's a moment where there's a note that's kind of going into this real sideways territory, and you hear Elvin Jones playing drums, pop, and then he pops him into a new part of the solo. It's an amazing
what band. That was
what a relationship. Yeah. Wow, that was really beautiful. And I was reading about it today, and you describe in your book the condition he was in when he shows up at the Village Vanguard in 1977.
Yeah.
And you're basically you had to basically hold him up. And take him there, and he basically almost passed out in the kitchen. It was like he's barely standing.
And that photograph was taken in the kitchen of the Village Vanguard, that hideous one.
Right.
The photographer said, "Are you sure you want that picture?" I said, "Yeah."
Yeah, wow.
I really do.
So I wanted, like, for people that don't maybe know the whole story, I mean, they can read the book, which they should. It's a tremendous book. And in a weird way, I think I got a hold of you, or I first heard about you, obviously I saw your name on the book, but Gary Giddens, the jazz critic. I got to know him in the last year. We became friends, and it was a great, fun thing for me. And he talked about you, and then I called you, and you said, "Oh, you got to read all the things he wrote about him." He wrote a tremendous story about Art Pepper and the Village Voice, I think.
Oh man, did he ever? Yeah. Gary really, really understood Art.
Yeah. Yeah. But when you met him at at Synanon, which is this sort of like, what do you tell people when they ask what Synanon is? You met him in this very unusual circumstance.
Yeah, it was a drug rehabilitation. It started out as a drug rehabilitation center, sort of based on a lot of AA principles, minus God. And but it was pretty good as that. And that's why I went in there, and that's why he went in there. And then it became, they called it a social movement. And my take on what happened, and it happened after we both left, was that it became a cult. And yeah, the guy who ran it, Chuck Diederich, just basically lost his mind. Power corrupts and drives you crazy too.
Right.
He just.
Did it, well, there's this kind of therapy session, group therapy session described in the book, The Game.
Oh, yeah.
The Game.
Yeah.
And so tell people what that was about, because, you know, you and I guess and Art, you know, would be in these circles with lots of other people, basically kind of degrading each other. It was like an ego destruction.
No.
Tell me about it. What was it like? What happened?
Well, first of all, you've got to realize you've lived with and worked with the people that you were in the games with.
Right.
So someone would indict you for something. And what would frequently happen, they'd say, oh, you left the bathroom sink dirty. You didn't clean up after yourself, right? And you'd start with that. And then it would evolve until you were telling all your troubles and people were talking to you and they knew everything about you pretty much. Yeah. And they still loved you. That was the thing about the Synanon game. It was not violent. It was not cruel. Although I understand there were games both before I came where they used to have these bloodbath games, they called them. And afterwards, when things got really weird. But I was there at the perfect moment. And so was Art. Yeah.
And so tell me about the Art Pepper you first saw. I mean, here he's got the prison tats. He's been through something. He's quite older than you, right?
15 years.
And so what was your, you know, you were, you know, he probably seemed somewhat romantic in that he had lived.
Extremely romantic. Yes,
yeah.
He was. He was my cup of tea. It wasn't just the music, although I certainly knew who he was. I had been a jazz fan in my teens. The first records I bought were Charlie Parker records. But what I discovered after he hit on me and we sort of started getting close is how funny he was. See, that's all I require of a mate, really, is that they make me laugh. And I've been very lucky that way. So Art made me laugh. He amazed me. And he had all these great stories about his life. I mean, what a life, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, I he was infatuated with me. And even though he wasn't really my type, I went for him in a big way, and he just hooked me and reeled me in. He really did.
Yeah. And there's so much involved in that. It got complicated as the years went on because he never really recovered from drugs. That was his life, and he was all in, really.
No, I came to realize that was the case.
Yeah.
It was you know, when people have cancer and they keep it, they treat it and they keep living. That's kind of how it was.
Right. Well, but it was probably a couple of years in when you came to the realization, this isn't going to change. Right. And also it's sort of a part of his, I don't know. Well, that's the question for you, is were drugs, part and parcel of his creative expression?
I don't think necessarily. I don't think so. I think that sometimes they got in the way, but frequently they also helped him. I mean, he was terrified every time he performed. I mean, really, seriously terrified.
Yeah.
And sometimes he'd vomit. And it was really, and he was so self-critical, incredibly self-critical. So that kind of made it possible for him to perform. Drinking was his real problem.
Right. Yeah. Well, and he wasn't alone in that. I mean, the whole jazz man, he was the quintessential kind of jazz guy that you would read about in like a noir, you know, from the 50s, LA, you know, when you think of that period, Chet Baker, Art Pepper, I mean, they're very similar in the lifestyle they were leading. Mm-hmm. And I mean, one part of it is that they saw themselves, or he saw himself, as like kind of a social outsider, right?
Completely,
And he never really got over that. Even when jazz was going mainstream or was mainly accepted, he still always carried with him this sense of himself as being kind of, you know, a rogue on the outside of society. And, you know, you mentioned that he wanted to live in bad neighborhoods, basically, because he didn't want to live with bourgeois people.
Not bad neighborhoods, but not bourgeois neighborhoods. When we left the place that we lived in Venice, in California, we had a great little apartment there, but the landlady went crazy and started breaking in. So we had to leave, and we moved to the Valley, since that seemed to be. But I was looking at other places, and I showed him a couple of places, and he said he wouldn't be comfortable there. And he was mainly concerned about being judged by the neighbors.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, one of the difficult parts of straight life, especially in our modern times, if your modern ear hears how he, you know, in the 50s, there were interracial bands, and it was common for white and black players to play together, and black players accepted white players more or less, you know. Mm-hmm. And but then the 60s came, and there was sort of an identity politics revolution. There was black power. And this really upset and hurt Art Pepper, because
it really did.
And he talks about it.
Yeah. He had two cultures that he felt relatively comfortable in before that. One of them was black culture, black musicians culture. He was accepted. He was on Central Avenue. His friends were black, you know, all of that. And when that happened, it was like he was kicked out of paradise.
Right.
The other culture that he felt comfortable in was the Mexican gangsters of East L.A.
Right.
They weren't like the guys today. They weren't gang guys. They were real gangsters and criminals. And he loved them. He was accepted by them. They admired him. They would come to hear him play. He would play in clubs in East L.A. So that was a culture that never forsook him.
Right.
But, yeah.
Well, it was really made clear, and it becomes really stark when he goes to prison, because in prison, it was like ethnic and racial gangs, right? And he has a black jazz musician friend who comes to him while he's in prison and says, "Hey, Art, I like you and everything, but I can't be seen talking to you because I'll get hurt." Right. Mm-hmm. And that's the world that he was having to confront. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was, you know, and by the way, it's one of the things about Art Pepper, and I think you'll agree with this, is like there's all this like rough kind of brutal crime and drugs and the outside of life. And at the core of it is this incredibly sweet, romantic, vulnerable sound. Right. I mean, that's the juxtaposition of Art Pepper, is like all kind of rough on the outside and in the center of this thing, right?
Yeah.
And tell me what it was like when he kind of got back into music. You know, there's a track on that record called Dr. Yo.
Mr. Yo.
Because he, you know, he didn't think he was going to be playing music again after he went through his trials of drug abuse in prison and everything.
Yeah. No. All I was, you know, I didn't think he was going to play music again. He said he wasn't. All I wanted to do was write Straight Life, basically. That was my entire, and I was stuck on him. You know, I was in love. But he went. He was asked to go to somebody got hold of Les Koenig, who was Contemporary Records, and said that they were having a big clarinet event, a clinic at a college back east, and they would really like Art to come and play the clarinet. And Art didn't even have a clarinet.
Right.
He borrowed one from Les's son, who is actually a cello player. Yeah, he borrowed this old beat-up clarinet, and he got his plane ticket, and he took off. And when he came back, he told me that this guy from the Buffet Horn Company, which was also Armstrong Musical Instruments in this country, said, "This is ridiculous that you don't have a good horn. What's going on?" And a few days later, this truck pulls up in front of my apartment. He wasn't living with me yet. And here come all these instruments. It was, and Art just said, "I can't believe that anybody is giving these to me," you know, because he thought that they would think he would sell them or pawn them or, you know. He couldn't believe that this guy had enough faith in him to give him these beautiful horns.
And that becomes that's a transformative moment for him. You know, as stories go, it's like it's a classic thing. There's a whole sort of scene in your book where they're laid out, these beautiful gleaming horns, and he gets back in touch with his music. And the record we heard earlier, The Lost Life, I mean, that was right after he had sort of rediscovered himself, really, his music. And
He wrote that in prison.
He did, right?
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Well, it's very, you can just hear the feeling of having, you know, I'm sure he had, did he? Well, I'm asking you, I guess, did he? He must have had a lot of regrets about how, you know, about the time he ended up spending in prison. I mean, or did he?
I don't know whether you'd call it regrets. There were times he felt like he had wasted his life.
Right.
But there were other times when he thought that that was what had made him who he was.
Right. Right.
Who he was and how he was able to play that goodbye, which he never played anything like that before he went through all that hell. So, you know, I don't know.
Right. And when he came back, that's the thing to know for like jazz fans. I mean, his playing in the 50s was great, and he was known for his ballads. He was always known as a great ballad player.
And a beautiful sound.
Yeah, great sound. I mean, and really just to the degree you can say natural, it just never felt forced or like he was just, you know, going through the motions with riffs or anything. But when he kind of comes out of the back end of all this difficult period in his life, he has embraced and absorbed Coltrane and some of this other playing. And it's really the way he fuses the romantic with the out playing that really gives him a new level of emotionality in the music.
Yeah.
So, you know, tell me about when here you are in Synanon hearing his stories. He's telling stories about being a junkie, his crazy upbringing, the crime and the, I mean, you know, in his story of shooting up for the first time in Chicago in 1950, boy, it almost makes you want to try it. I mean, he does not, you know, look back on his life or see the arc of his life as a, you know, it's not a recovery narrative. It's, you know,
quite au contraire. It wasn't a recovery narrative.
So tell me when you started, what story is really inspired you to think, we got to write a book. We have to do the book.
I don't even know. I think it was the sheer effect of all of them. You know, I would hear about when he was with Stan Kenton. I probably heard some version of the shooting up in Chicago story.
Yeah.
I undoubtedly heard some of the stuff. I mean, you know, I got a little bit of everything and I just knew. Actually, I knew this was my ticket, quite seriously. It was selfishly, even though I was in love with it. I knew that this was finally, I had something I could do.
Right.
And I mean, we all look for something we can do. So that was
thing. He gave you purpose and he needed somebody like you to manage his,
one of his, when I interviewed this one guy that he'd been in prison with, The guy said very perceptively, you know, because he knew him outside of prison as well. He said he always has to have a woman who's basically running the show.
Right. And you see that in the book. I mean,
yeah,
some of them are not as good at running the show, or they just got they went down with him. You know, they just there's a whole scene in the book where he and whatever woman he's with at the time, they're so whacked out on drugs that they're like crawling across the floor to find the door, and they're just so
they couldn't find the door. That's
yeah, yeah,
Diane. Oh
yeah.
My God.
Yeah, who's he wrote a song called Diane that was on one of his records that was just reissued. That's a beautiful song, ballad. But one thing I wanted to ask you is so this is an album called The Trip.
Yeah.
He has an amazing monologue on the back here about how in prison, the prisoners to pass the time would tell each other stories.
Right.
Because that's all they had to do. And whoever was the best storyteller, who had the most experience in life, who was telling stories of their crimes or the sex with the women that they had, everybody would gather around them and just want to hear it. And they would talk and talk and talk and talk. And he says, well, that's basically what it's like when you're an experienced jazz player and you have so much experience and so many stories to tell through your horn, right? And I thought it was a beautiful anecdote and very true to him.
Mm-hmm.
But I felt
he
like I had
the
trip
to in prison too.
That's right. He wrote The Trip and also in prison. And and this has Elvin Jones playing drums on it. Incredible drummer.
Yes. Yeah.
And I had to ask you, I just saw your cat go across the screen there.
Yeah.
And there's a cat on The Trip.
Oh, yeah. I insisted that picture be on the album. That was Junior Cat.
His name was Junior Cat, and there's a song called Junior Cat.
Yes, there is. That's
I'm putting it all together. I'm slow.
But illustration.
Yeah. Oh, that's great. What a fantastic record. And just, you know, earlier I told the anecdote of giving that record to Beto O'Rourke, which is sort of a funny thing. And I gave this one to Joaquin Phoenix when I profiled him for Vanity Fair. I know you like Joaquin, right?
I love him.
Yeah, he's an amazing actor. And I can see him playing, you know, yeah. I'm just putting it out there.
Everybody's putting it out there. No.
I know. I know. We're going to talk about that in a minute. Somebody just told me that years ago, Matt Dillon wanted to do it and even read some parts from the book and wanted to really, you know, had a whole fantasy of doing it. But
people have wanted to do it.
Right. You mentioned Johnny Depp.
I had dinner with Johnny Depp.
Oh, my God. So I can see him totally being into this. But what was the upshot of that? Was he charming? Did he really put on the hard sell? What was his approach?
No, Johnny does not sell.
He's
very laid back. And I think he's from Florida. There's something Southern about his manners, quite seriously.
Right.
But no, he was interested. And we were sitting at the table having dinner with him and his agent. It was almost just me and Johnny, which would have been great. But the agent was there. And Johnny, I said, so I can use your name to raise money for this movie? And he said, yes. And she said, wait a minute.
Yeah.
So the way it worked out, it didn't happen. It just didn't happen. We had some things going on, and it became clear right away that I needed some controls. And it wasn't Johnny's fault. I think it was probably the agent who wanted. Oh, she did. She tried to put together a package with Bob Dylan's crowd. You know, those. Who's that guy that he toured with? You should know this, Joe.
His guitar player?
What?
His guitar player?
Famous, they toured the roaming, the roving.
Oh, Rolling Thunder Review, yeah.
I guess.
Yeah.
One of the players, anyway, they wanted to do it. They wanted to produce it. And Johnny's agent thought it was a great idea. I did not.
Right. Now, so, tell me your feeling about this. I think it's really, I mean, listen, your putting that book together was a life's work. It took you a long time. It was like blood, sweat, and tears because you were with Art Pepper. And, you know, and so years later, people love that story. I love that book. Of course, I'd love to see a movie of it. But mm-hmm. on some level, you want to be able to have some control of it or some say over it. And mm-hmm. so is it just boiled down to, you know, that nobody in Hollywood's willing to give you that control?
No, they're not. They don't give any, I mean, really, they don't do it, especially to a widow. I mean, if you're Patty Chayefsky, you can get that kind of control. But right. me, why? And I think they're probably right. I might be unreasonable.
Well, you're self-actualized enough to know it. That's good.
Yeah.
And, you know, but is it possible that somebody could come along who had the right attitude, who you could get along with and have it happen?
It's for them to get along with me. I'll get along with anybody as long as they, you know, include me. But right. they don't want to. They want to give me money and make me walk away.
Right. So. Right. That's, yeah. No, that's not untypical.
And in fact, I was talking to one of them. I got pretty far in Hollywood with all that. And I still remember a meeting with a producer, a known European producer. He's done a number of movies, some of them even pretty good. And I had a woman who was a producer for me, right? And we finally got into this office, lawyer's office in Beverly Hills, and I had a lawyer. And they said, why does LAURIE need a lawyer?
Yeah.
And I said, well, I own the book. And they said, my producer had told them she did.
Right.
The minute they knew that they had to deal with me,
yeah.
it was all over.
Yeah,
lawyer laid out, you know, whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
And they said, never mind.
Well, you know, on some level, I'm disappointed or sad that it hasn't been done. But at the same time, biopics are often really awful.
Are they?
Yeah,
how many have been good? Come on, seriously.
Yeah, they're not usually that great.
None of them have been good. You know what's good is documentaries. Documentaries
right.
are good, but
yeah.
biopics are terrible. The best one I've seen is probably the Ray Charles one, and it wasn't that good. The
right.
Bird one was terrible. Really
right.
was
oh,
bad.
Yeah.
I mean, that wonderful movie starring Dexter Gordon was not a biopic, and it was really Around Midnight. That was
right.
really good, but, you know.
So here's what I want to ask you. One of the sort of uncomfortable things that you read in his book is when in the late 60s he has a spleen rupture.
Ugh.
And he has this horrible hernia that is sort of more dramatic and horrible than you would usually see people have. I mean,
saw the pictures in my book, right?
Yeah, yeah, where it
and
sticks
in the
way
documentary.
Out. Yeah.
Somebody said they were cut out of the documentary.
It's in the documentary, and
yeah.
he has to wear a girdle. You know, he would strap it in, and it would kind of like, you know, and it's sort of
he
horrifying.
Had no muscles there.
Right, and it would because they couldn't fix it without hurting him, or he couldn't
without
do it.
Without killing him, basically, yeah.
And you know, when he's doing the Vanguard thing, you describe his skin is yellow. He's like, you know, at death's door. He's done too much, you know. And I just finished reading the end where you know, your last times with him and just how brutal it was and sad. And you were, you know, controlling then, too. You know, you were like, this is my life and it's mm-hmm. about to go and you're having these revelations. But I, you know, I guess the most obvious question is, like, why did you stay with him? I mean, that's the title of the book, you know, Why I Stayed With Him. But why did you?
I stayed with him because, unlike a lot of people, he I mean, he was, he adored me. I need to be adored, seriously. And yeah, he adored me. And he really did not criticize me. Rarely did he ever criticize me. He thought I was beautiful and smart. He relied on me. He liked to talk with me, you know, and he made me laugh like crazy. And he, I mean, he was a good companion. Isn't that weird? Yes, he was a very good companion, except when he wasn't.
Right. Yeah, you describe he had a personality, repep, or it was like pepper backwards when he was...
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
When he would act like a horrible, like, you know, Rutra, junkie.
Rutra was when he was on downers and nodding, right?
Yeah, right.
That's Arthur spelled backwards. And Repep was when he was high on, basically on coke.
Yeah. Right. And he kind of pulled you into some of that for periods of time.
I was not real resistant.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, it was... You know, it's the kind of life that I'm sure when it was over and you recovered from it, you know, you weren't necessarily looking to get into another relationship like that.
Never. It was... Oh, no. And you know what? I'll tell you something. Some woman talked to me before I wrote this second book, and she was talking about this man who was, you know, so unreliable, and he get loaded and then he'd be so sweet, and then and she said, I don't know whether to stay with him or not. I said, is he a genius?
Yeah. Oh my God. Yeah.
And she said, no. I said, why are you staying?
Yeah. Well, and that's what I know.
I was brought up to believe that the noblest thing a person could be was an artist. I was brought up that way.
I know you were. And I, you know, we're going to have to go soon, but I want to just say some final words here. You know, your cousin is Eve Babbitt, who I wrote about in my book. And you guys come from a really interesting bohemian family of, like, you know, communists, you know.
Trotskyists.
Trotskyists, right.
You've got to be very careful about those designations.
Yeah, I appreciate you correcting me. And, you know, I think that the reason people... love Art Pepper and that music is that the spirit of it is so pure, you know, and you don't doubt when you read his book that he's pure and honest, because he's confessional even about what a horrible person he can be and was at times, right? But at the same time, he's a totally romantic person, and in a way your standards for wanting to live a full life where, you know, you grabbed onto a comet and you wrote it, right? I mean, you experienced that.
Exactly.
And I love it. And I love your book. I love both your books. And I want to tell everybody to read them and listen to these records. They're really like emotional expressions.
Thank you for playing that thing from the Vanguard. I haven't heard it in years. And I was just blown away by it again.
Well, I'm so happy you were. I'm going to, for those who are interested, I'm going to pop over to my other account, Joe Hagan TV, and I'm going to go live again, and I'm going to play more Art Pepper. We're going to have an after hours, okay? So look for me going live in a few minutes, and I'm going to play all my favorite Art Pepper tracks. And I hope you'll all join me there. And thank you so much, LAURIE Pepper. I could talk for like hours, is the truth, but we have this like limited time. But you're a gracious person for doing this, and you've lived a beautiful life, and you love what you're doing with his legacy and keeping it alive.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. And I'm signing off Joe's Records and Tapes. Love to all the people. Hang in there. Stay healthy, and we'll catch you on the flip side.